Today is a high Sabbath, as I prayed earlier, if you weren't with us. It was called Shabbat Hagadol. Why don't you try to say that with me? Shabbat Hagadol. It means the great Sabbath. It always marks the time, the Sabbath just before Passover. Passover starts next Friday, and we had the special reading because we start looking for leaven on Thursday, I believe, if my brain is working correctly. So, this week's Torah portion we have is called Zav. It is portion number 26, I believe, in which we read about the priests being commanded. The word Zav, if you want to say that with me, Zav means command. And it comes from the second verse of the portion. And depending on if you're looking at a Christian Bible or a Hebrew Bible, it'll start in a different place. In the Hebrew Bible, it's verse 2. And in the Christian Bible, I believe it's verse 9. So it says this in Hebrew, Zav et Aharon ve et banav lemor. Speak to Aaron and his sons, saying. In this passage, it seems like God is repeating himself because we have the same laws being expressed about the five offerings that are found in this section. There were five offerings that were brought to the tabernacle. There was the olah, or the burnt offering. There was the mincha, or the grain offering. There was the chatat, which was the sin offering. The shlama, which was the peace offering, as it's loosely translated, but it meant more the fellowship offering. And there was the asham, the guilt offering. These five offerings are recounted again with certain laws. The difference is, though, remember how that second verse starts, command to Aaron and his priests and his sons. These were the very priests. So in chapters 6 and 7 of this passage, we have specific laws that are speaking directly to the priests. How the priests are supposed to act, how the priests are supposed to live, how the priests are supposed to dress, how the priests are supposed to clean the house of the Lord, how the priests are supposed to even eat, and what and when they're to eat and how they're to eat. And so all these things in the first two chapters deal with these things. We have something in chapter 6, the Esh Tamid, in which we're told that there's to be an everlasting fire, an everlasting fire. And in many ways, you can compare this to many different things. The rabbis like to talk about the fact that this meant that there was a place of atonement that all the country of Israel could come. And maybe that suits or maybe that fits on one hand. On the other hand, it also represents what kind of relationship we have with the Lord and how we are in turn to reciprocate that relationship with him, always willing to kindle our fire, kindle ourselves, willing to love him and serve him. This was not just for the priests specifically, but it was also something that we can apply to our own lives that we see later on that in the days of as days get latter and things change, we know that the love of many will grow cold. And so it's important to kindle your love relationship with the Lord and keep it off flaming, not letting that light burn out, not letting that light get out of control. It's the same thing in terms of how we live for the Lord and what we do. The Haftorahs, which I hope those that follow the Torah portions each week, they read from the Haftorah portions. They're just as valid and important. The Haftorah that goes with this comes from Jeremiah chapter 7, in which the Lord rebukes the priests very strongly for some of the wicked things they're doing. Unfortunately, this Haftorah is moved aside, and a better Haftorah is moved in for Shabbat Hagadol. That Haftorah comes from Malachi chapter 3, verses 4 to 24, or verse 4 to chapter 4, verse 6, in which God tells what it will be like at the end of times. He rebukes the priests very harshly and tells them they need to get their lives in order and start living a righteous life for him. And from that, God goes on to say, when they do, there will be blessings that will come. The nations will see how happy they are. And there will be blessings upon blessings if you read to the end of chapter 3. In the beginning of chapter 4, or in chapter 3, verse 19, we have a passage in which God talks about sending Elijah the prophet. Many of us know this passage quite well because it's quoted in the Seder, in the Haggadah. And in this passage, God makes a promise. He also gives us a command to keep close to the Torah of Moses. It was such a huge point. And in turn, Malachi tells us that the spirit of Elijah, the very spirit, is to come again and that it will bring revival to our hearts. This is so important because in each Passover season, we can see God's deliverance. We can see God's growth coming forth in our lives again. The portion then concludes with an important verse, which I hope all of you know, because in the latter days, it speaks of when God will do a wondrous thing by causing his children to turn back to the fathers, and first that the fathers would also turn back to the children. We have much of that happening in our congregation, and I believe it's because we are in the latter days that God has moved on many of us parents to pray for our children, to care about our wayward children, and to not give up, but to push in and believe God for our wayward children. And in turn, God promises that the children will turn back to the fathers, and which that's a kind of interpreted in a couple ways, because we see many people taking a need to care for their aging parents right now in our congregation, which really fits because it's children being turned back to their parents wanting to care and love them as they come to that end of life. But at the same time, it's also to mean that your children will come back to you and live for the Lord out of repentance. This is such an important Haftorah. I hope everyone goes home and reads it and knows it, because this is what God is doing in the latter days. The portion then ends in chapter 8 by the same inauguration of Aaron coming into the priesthood. This speaks about Aaron's authority. Why do I say that? Because this is the second time in over a month or two that God has seen the need to talk to us about anointing Aaron as the high priest. It's important that all of us learn what an authority is and how we learn to live and walk under authority. Each of us, even from Haim himself, who is, quote, one of our chief rabbis, or elder rabbis, senior rabbi, whatever you want to call him, he has to be even under authority. Every person has to be under some kind of authority. And all authority comes from God. That's why God takes it again to say, it's just important for this to be our authority, the high priest. And in turn, the high priest has very, very important rules that he's to follow as well. Because if he didn't, he would die. It was that serious. If the high priest didn't follow the rules, he would die. And so it's an important lesson for us to understand that authority can be both a negative thing and a positive thing. When we live and walk under authority, we'll find God's blessing. When we're outside of it, we'll find something else. The part I've chosen to chant from is from Leviticus chapter 7. I thought it was interesting that this is one of the first times that we see how thanksgiving is coming about through worship. In this passage, God tells his people to worship him in the fellowship offerings as to give him thanks. Whether it's thanksgiving from some kind of sickness they've overcome, or some kind of danger they've been saved from, or whether it's because they're keeping a vow that they agreed to do to the Lord. The fact is, when people offered thanksgiving, it wasn't something that was difficult. In fact, it was something very easy to do. The poorest person could bring a grain offering, a handful of grain, and offer that as a thanksgiving offering. But the richest person could bring the greatest animal and offer it. The point of the matter was, as we read through this passage, it was to all go to the Lord and to the priests. And that's part of what I want to challenge us to do. I know that everybody here goes through very difficult things. Everybody has trials, and I know you can probably just ask your neighbor what they're going through, or maybe even see someone and know what they're going through. But it's just important to share in the thanksgivings as well, to know what God has done and how God has blessed you. Now, one of the things that happened to me this week may not be that great to you, but it was to me. I was able to find a place that I've been looking for. Every Wednesday, I come down on the light rail, and I'm not looking for a ride. This is not like, can somebody pick me up for Wednesday? It's not about that. It's that I like to be out exercising in the sun, and every week, I have not been able to find the light rail station. I wander all over the place. I find all the spin bikes. I find people. I find where I've gone too far. But this week, as I was praying that God would lead me, I found the light rail station. And I gave him much thanks for that. Now, it might be something that isn't that big a deal to you, but it was a big deal to me because I struggle at times to find things. It's just part of my life. I get to look for things. So that's why I'm a prayer person. I like to seek and seek and seek and seek the Lord. And the fact is, God wants us to do the same. The scripture tells us when one part of the body rejoices, we all in turn rejoice with it. And so it's just as important to bring our thanksgiving offerings before the Lord and lift them up. Part of the point of that was to say, this is holy to the Lord, like a heave offering, but it was also waved before the Lord to say, God, you're sovereign. So Lord, as we rejoice in this portion, I thank you for what you've been doing here at Yeshua Tzion. Thank you for those that come and serve and work hard to make everything happen. I thank you especially for the people that clean up, Lord. Many times they're not thanked at all, and maybe they even think that you don't see what they're doing. But Lord, I want to thank them specifically, and I want everyone to give them a round of applause because they work sometimes the hardest to clean the congregation. Lord, teach us to be a people of gratitude. This offering will not stop just because Messiah shows up. We will still worship you and give you thank offerings in your kingdom. We give you much honor and glory for this word. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen.